understanding this is a work in progress, understanding that we all couldn't type at the same time, and understanding that I haven't had a chance to go over every word with my colleagues, but hopefully I've captured them, and also understanding that we're looking for, this is an open forum, and we're looking for good input from everybody. I think I'm at about the 80th percentile. There's a few things that I need to fill in towards the end. But with that, let me just go ahead and start. First, the introduction. We started off with exploration technology because that's what we're asked to talk about, but we gradually morphed away from that after some initial conclusions and looked for some sort of an outcome that we could, in English we use top dead center, where you are kind of stuck on a stroke of an engine where you're neither in compression nor in an ignition, so you're kind of stuck at a point and you need to start and get some momentum going. And so we looked for options and that might both fold in terms of funding, in terms of exploration, in terms of the environmental aspect. So we actually have taken a little bit of the environmental issue because we view that as a real problem for all of the contractors and, in fact, for the entire aspect of getting the nodules going. But it's because right now the risk of coming up with an environmental problem exists across every single contractor individually, not collectively. So with that, although several experts believe that many of the individual technologies needed for the basic functions needed to collect CCZ nodules are accounted for by capabilities commercially available today, others more recently attracted to analyzing the attractiveness of nodule harvesting call for the ISA to aid in the analysis by helping to provide a following set of things. The current status of the technology development or the state of technology in development for exploiting and readiness for exploration and ultimately harvesting nodules at depth and especially those that would minimize or avoid environmental disturbance. Also for a set of reference models for estimated costs because without knowing the cost, a techno-economic viability study cannot be done, which is the primary step before going after the large investment needed for actual nodule harvesting. Also to provide a state of the process technology, the extractive metallurgy and successive progress as such technologies improve. Finally, to the means to evaluate the additional economic value of the nodules provided by such other elements, such as titanium and the rare earth series, both in terms of percent content and any commentary on process methods or cost. Since any chance to increase the value of recovery or any technology to reduce recovery or processing costs is crucial to nodule harvesting, frequent such analysis should help existing contractors and attract new interest. Even when component technologies are mature, there is no openly available operational integrated system tailored to CCZ ops, either at scale or subscale. Thus, a significant confidence-building milestone would be an open demonstration with today's technology in a subscale, in-water, at-depth, trial nodule collection operation. Such a set of activities would give capital markets, potential contractors, and technology providers increased urgency to focus on ISA and contractor activities. One approach to attain such a demonstration is envisioned in the latter sections of this workshop report by using such a system to provide environmental data and validated procedures to eventually provide a reference document that would fulfill the claimant's environmental contractual requirements as far as possible. With the relative maturity of components, exploration technology is suggested to focus more on the gaps that need to be filled for the contractors. Two needs seem to rise to high importance, environmental data and nodule data for specific contractor fields. Environmental data and plans are needed to fulfill the contractual obligations, particularly with respect to CCZ contractor areas. These needs appear to be so similar to all contractors that some collective efforts should be considered to reach a common or reference contract answer more speedily. Additionally, data detailed enough to make decisions on the order of importance of nodule fields and perhaps suggesting if tailored collection techniques might be required to harvest within the claims is needed. So thinking about the biota and the environmental data, additional scientific research to fulfill the requirements of the contracts to include specific focus on CCC biota is needed. Biology census to develop a baseline and provide a common understanding should be a high priority. Specifically, new sensors, for instance, are there electrical or chemical means for standoff detection of the flora and the fauna, should be considered to determine if there are more rapid capabilities to increase spatial awareness of the flora and the fauna for environmental planning, or even to modulate mining behavior during actual harvesting operations. We entitled the second section Micro Exploration. To date, technology has yielded data for the macro, CCZ-wide, that is generally quite satisfactory for the contractor baseline use. However, for their particular use in fields for planning harvest operations, more data is needed and may suggest that a common or a baseline vehicle be investigated based on an open architecture standard discussed below to, inter alia, increase data commonality, decrease unit and maintenance costs, allow new technologies, for instance sensors like gamma rays, lasers, batteries, communications et al., to be inserted more easily, allow multiple vendors to compete, allow collaboration between vehicles, enable easier and more complete data fusion, standardize data and communications to reduce costs. Such a micro data collector would provide fine-grained data needed to assess in detail anticipated actual harvesting operations and would likely be useful in monitoring or post-harvest environmental assessments with confidence building standardized sensors and data. Another section called funding. Funding for at least the biota environmental exploration technology above and perhaps data collection and operational validation should be assessed against the missions of such organizations as the USA National Institutes of Health, the philanthropic Howard Hughes Medical Institute, the Chilean Servicio Nacional de Salud, and other similar national and charitable organizations. These groups and institutions should be excited to be able to fund early benthic biotic research firsthand under the ISA Scientific Research Authority and perhaps realize some of the potential step function increases in unique medical and genetic knowledge leading to dramatic improvements in human health. From the ISA point of view, the primary goal would be to have such research fund most, if not all, the requirements of the needs of the contractor's environmental section, having the additional benefit that the data would be provided from a common, disinterested third party. Standards. A great service to contractors would be for the ISA to lead in the construct common or reference models to fulfill contractual needs common to all claimants, especially as new data is collected in for instance, the biotica. A fresh effort should be led by the ISA to review existing data, point out inconsistencies in data formulation or metrics, and lead in the workshops necessary to establish a consistent and achievable set of data standards going forward, perhaps reviewable in the order of every 5 years or so. In those technical portions of anticipated contractual submissions, the ISA should develop and validate model processes and methods. Where possible, these standards should recognize and collaborate with ongoing international efforts like the OOI, the Ocean Observatory Initiative, to reduce costs and ensure well-established international standards. Indeed, ISA may be able to simply validate some of the environmental methods or sensors to speed development of a reference model. For instance, permanent mooring activities and associated communication schemes might be adapted fully to standardize environmental monitoring of nodule post-harvesting operations. Some combination is going to work. Environmental and pilot efforts. The technical working group acknowledges that a successful pilot project showing the technical feasibility of nodule exploitation would be of utmost importance for any possible investor. The results of that project should be published and serve as a calibration for cost-benefit calculations and technical assessments. The technical working group also encourages deliberations to determine if the enterprise of the authority could be used to, without full activations, for instance, a pre-activation ad interim activity, to initiate and coordinate a project using an appropriate reserved area. based on receiving some significant degree of funding mentioned above. One concept would have the ISA leadership lead a set of demonstrations to determine the sets of data necessary to answer the full environmental impact assessments and post-harvest implications necessary to form a reference document that meets all important contract needs. In this matter, the joint contractor ISA efforts would greatly reduce risk, promote uniformity, and be backed by common data and validated procedures for measurement. Not fully developed, but an additional question is, would some form of the demonstration allow some set of developing nations to be invited to participate in these trials so that we could better understand the issues of an enterprise startup and some of the costs associated both from the ISA point of view as well as the developing nations point of view. A relatively undeveloped section on open architecture, but it basically means that promoting the ISA as the leader so that we can allow off-the-shelf technology to be used in an open manner such that all participants understand from the both the supplying side and the buying side, and further broken down to the point where even small vendors, small shops, five people anywhere in the world can basically do some of these parts, and increases competition, increases innovation, and it's a proven means that we have found in programs that I've worked with that it take tens of billion dollar programs and brings them down to hundreds of thousands of dollars in some cases, saving billions of dollars, saving time, increasing the capability for inserting technology, and if run in the correct process, open and is open to all competitors. Without regard to other observations, these are two other things, visualizing capability. Exploratory research combined with increased sophistication and volume of sensor data suggests that an important baseline technology will be data fusion that is able to be presented by ever better visualization techniques. And so we encourage the Secretariat to keep this as a high priority of a technology that is hard for any one contractor to develop by themselves. Technical and program management. The ISA should consider that as harvesting operations are closer to reality, that individual contractor advocacy within the ISA might well be served by program managers able to work issues with a more robust technical staff to minimize losing lessons learned from previous research and operations. And that's it. Questions?
Do you have any questions or comments for the technology group?
That's the group, not me.
Yeah, for the whole group, of course. No, everybody's happy with those recommendations. Jim?
This is not really a question, it's probably more of a comment. One of the things that I see in this whole conversation when we're talking about biota and environmental data and so forth, I really believe that it's important that whatever group comes together to go out and do this research is a multidisciplinary team. Not just a biologist, not just a geologist, not just a chemist, but a whole group of them coming together so that they understand the environment in its totality. The same that there should be an engineering component with it as well, so that if the scientists come across something that they can't understand or they don't have the instrumentation available to be able to really look at it in an appropriate fashion to get a good understanding of what's going on, you have an engineering team that can design and build instrumentation required to be able to see things. That'd be my only comment.
I like that.
Thank you very much. Elva?
I would like to suggest that as technology develops, we should probably consider new strategies and leave that as an open possibility. As for instance, that we could have in real time transmission of data that can be used and renew models or reassess what we know at that moment. But we need to leave that window open for future development.
Full agreement.
Yeah. And the other point was the moorings that I have been so much insisting. Maybe to have these sites, at least to have observatories at each of the recognized areas that have been recognized by the model.
And hopefully drawing from the others' experience so that we can get the cheapest set that's tailored to the needs of either the ISA, the contractor, or both.
Very good. Dr. Zhou?
Yeah, for the technology development issue, and I would like to suggest could it be generalized in three aspects. Actually, you also mentioned that first should be the resource exploration or assessment, and the second could be, the mining, but certainly the people don't know. Or when the mining technology will be necessary to prepare, or what's the time of the mining? But it seems for some resource in some particular area, the mining maybe in next decades would be possible. And the third one, I would like to say also the most aspects is environment issues. And it's technology related with the environment is most the most advanced and also the really necessary. And I agree with James just mentioned. And those environment issue should be very closely integrated of the different disciplines, and could also do in the way step by step, and should also really closely related with the findings we now have. I think maybe our environment group will also have some document, and I like to ask the technology people to combine with such idea very closely, and also make it a multi-discipline development.
Yes, my comment on your comment. I would only add one more paragraph. The environmental aspects, I believe, ought to be tied to the reality of what the mining is, not what the reality of the biology is.
Yes, yes.
Because if you're operating at 10 centimeters and we're only making a 3-centimeter
yes.
impact,
yeah.
or maybe we have a technology that has a 1-centimeter impact, mm-hmm. let's not worry too much about the 10 centimeter. And so that's why we have this tied to a subscale demonstration, so you're doing real things with real machines, and you can take a look at those. You are potentially bringing in some new players to find out how they're going to react.
Yeah, yeah.
All the existing players are on the side in a reserved area with the ISA, and hopefully funding from somebody else, so we have a third party in there to help, so that nobody can say that we're doing something different. And then that allows us, I believe, to then come up and answer what we can't do right now. I mean, I don't believe any one contractor really wants to try to asynchronously submit a environmental statement and then have that, with all the arrows that's going to attract from around the world, have the next person come in 2 or 3 years later with theirs, and then we have twice, then we're going to have an exponential set of arrows. So I say, let's get together, let's try to get the funding, because I believe that there's genetic and medical kinds of interests out there that somehow we ought to be able to excite, and then let's go do something that will satisfy them with their money and satisfy us with our need to fulfill the ISA. Then we have a reference model, maybe have to be tweaked everything, but we have validated procedures, we have standards, we have sensors, we know where to go, but it will continue to move. I mean, it is a dynamic process,
that needs to be assessed as new sensors and new technology and new biota are found, because inevitably something's going to pop up on a routine basis. So we have to have we can't be brittle. We need to have the technology agility to run with that. That's a long paragraph to your comment, I know.
I fully agree with what you state. And in my mind, and I think I like the style of geological model of manganese nodules really much. And I think this style, this organization or this method for the speed authority is a very good start for the international cooperation on one subject. And I think for the recommendation of this workshop to the CBD authority, I would like maybe slow the development we together, and we should finalize some specific programs could do really effective and internationally. And maybe after the, some other recommendation, we could finalize such program. And I would like to say, in technology aspects, I like the word high resolution, real time, in situ, long term observations, and also experiments really well. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zhou. Are there any more questions or comments on this working group? Peter.
For the future, when exploitation methods are realized, compete with each other. Some are really soft mining methods, minimize the impact on the environment, but others are hard methods. And is there any idea that the authority has a kind of control for this kind of future technologies to say, well, this is all right, can be done, but this is a method which might be a very fast one or so, but it's harmful for the biology on the seafloor, and this could not be realized. Is that one idea? Because we are talking about exploration, but in 5 years we are talking about exploitation. What we are doing, which technology is working on the ocean floor, and what is the philosophy of the authority? I would like to know it. Because time is going on. In 5 years, we are sitting here and talking about the machines which run about the ocean floor and kill all the animals. Maybe not, but there are differences.
Yeah, there's a broad framework for what you're talking about. There's a very broad framework. But that aspect of the regulations has not been developed. I believe it's through sessions like this that the issues are raised and we go forward. What we've done for polymetallic nodules so far is to provide a broad framework for exploration. We have not talked about exploitation at all. We've been focused solely on exploration. There are many other questions that have to do with exploitation that I believe we have to start looking at as we speak. But to date, what we have done is to develop this broad framework for exploration, and to see to what extent possible it works through the various monitoring in forms of the annual reports. But we have not taken our thinking much beyond that, and it's something that is obvious that we would have to start working on right now. Thank you.
Yeah. You know that the Koreans already has a mining machine which was tested in deep water conditions, and from Dr. Tupong, who visited me in September in Berlin, he said, well, next year we have a real test in a nodule field. Yeah, so technology is going on.
You know what? I saw the Korean experiment. They still didn't go much further than 100 meters.
Yes.
And they still didn't go any further than using
next year.
Yeah, but because all they did was, it was all artificial nodules and 100 meters.
If I might jump in here a little bit, you know, one of the things that I was hearing Miles talk about of, you know, getting an international group together where you had an operation that was really going out and analyzing the exploitation technology that would be used. The cost of the vessel is going to be your big CapEx cost, okay? And if you look at Cordi, Comra, NIOT, et cetera, they all have their own mining vehicles. To put all three of those mining vehicles on board a ship at one time is not really a big deal as long as you have a common, you know, riser connection. And so there is an opportunity to go out and do actual evaluation of the collection systems and do an analysis as to which is working correctly. You know, have the moorings around the outside looking at the sediment plumes and so forth that are coming off it. But you can do real world analysis. So while these operations are going, having international cooperation where it's not just one nodule collector that's going out and being evaluated, but bring a couple of them out there, I think you could really leverage the value of that operation.
Thank you.
Any further questions or comments on technology group number two? Okay, our next presentation is from the working group number one, which was focused on the extension of the model to new areas and correction of the existing model to make it more complete. And that presentation chair, or the chair of that working group who will be given the presentation, is Dr. Kaiser de Souza, who is the Director of Marine Geology for the Brazilian Geological Survey. Kaiser?
Thank you, Charles. Okay, so for the work group one, it was given three different tasks. The first one was to develop recommendations on how to take the geological model of Clarion-Clipperton Zone to Indian Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, Peru Basin, Mexico Basin, and elsewhere. The second task was to identify shortfalls, deficiencies, and limitations of the model on application to other areas. And the third one was to make recommendations on how to improve the model and the prospect guide. So we had four presentations, one for the Indian Ocean and another for the Atlantic, another for Peru Basin, and another for Mexico Basin. So I start with Indian Ocean. This presentation introduced the history of exploration in Central Indian Ocean. It showed that several distinct basins exist, and there are, and these all have some potential for nodules. The density of data is greatest in the Central Indian basins and remain poor in the other basins. Everywhere, data coverage is much lower than in the CCC. There was a discussion on the general characteristics of the Indian Oceans. And after this discussion, the participants concluded that the CCZ model may be applicable to the Central Indian Basin and recommended that model be tested in this region. These recommendations is based on the strong similarity of several factors, including water depth situated below the CCD, sediment types, recent volcanism, and the structural settings. Discussion showed that other factors may be different, such as pattern of primary production and different nucleus composition, which are probably due to proximity to volcanic island arcs. In order to increase the knowledge of the area, it was strongly recommended that contractors make data available. Participants felt that the CCZ model needs first to be tested in the Central Indian Basin before it can be considered as a global model for polymetallic nodules. Okay, concerning Atlantic Ocean, a presentation on a collaborative project by countries bordering the South Atlantic Ocean was presented with the aim to identify how this project could provide a framework for the application of the geological model and the prospect guides of the CCZ in the South Atlantic Ocean. The aim of the project was to gather, assemble, integrate, and make available in a single georefered environment all the available data and information on the geology and mineral resource of the South Atlantic Ocean. Participants expressed their views on the different parameters of the South Atlantic Ocean comparing to the CCZ. These parameters included the strong continental control of sedimentation due to presence of rivers from sides, presence of Antarctic currents, lack of silicious sediments, low carbonate compensation zone, etc. Participants felt that this difference could difficult the application of the CCZ model in the region. However, the project could benefit from the prospector guide. Participants felt also that comparing to other regions, that was there was a differential in the amount of available data in the South Atlantic Ocean, and that the existing data would be insufficient to make a full test of the CCZ model in this region. Therefore, it was proposed to proceed in different phases. First phase would be an ISA-led initiative facilitating the gathering of existing data of the South Atlantic Ocean from all coastal states and other interested states, major data holders, as well as contractors, to be consolidated into an integrated database. Participants agreed that this phase could be completed in 2 years program. Second phase would be a test of the CCZ model on the best areas of the South Atlantic Ocean. Participants concluded that the proposal for the South Atlantic Ocean project could be a good opportunity for the application of the prospector guide in this region. The participants felt that although the scarcity of data, the project could provide the framework needed for search for areas where factors, conditions that control CCZ nodules formation exist in the South Atlantic. So, going to Mexico Basin, there was a presentation also on the characteristics of these areas. And the presentation showed that the metal content of nodules in these areas is strongly related to a direct fluvial contribution. In terms of primary productivity, participants found that there are mixed conditions like upwelling, nutrients mixed conditions, no thermoclines, silica mixed and produce particles that sinks with contribute to the nodule generation. This particular setting can only occur near the coast or near upwelling regions like Peru and Ecuador, but not where stable oligotrophic conditions pertain. Another important factor is the regional dissolved oxygen distribution in the East Pacific. And dissolved oxygen can be delivered by deep Antarctic water controlling CCD in CCZ area. So this presentation showed that there are important differences between CCZ and the Mexican basin. So the participants recommended that the CCZ model be revisited, taking into account the results presented regarding Mexico basin, and particularly the importance of hydrothermal inputs and the lateral transport of sediments of terrigenous origin. So it was a recommendation for the CCZ model. Concerning Peru Basin, a presentation on the geology and nodules resource of Peru Basin was given by one of the participants. Some of the differences between this area and the CCZ were exposed, including the presence of mud closer to the shelf and the high concentration of micro nodules. Another critical issue exposed was the pattern of the bioproductivity isolines. The Peru Basin has three times more than CCZ, up to 100 grams per square meters per year. The nodules of the Peru Basin have very fast growth, and its coverage is higher, around 45 kilograms per square meters. Peru Basin has also high organic flux from surface, which much higher genetic conditions than in the CCZ. So therefore, the working group recommended that the analysis and results from the Peru basins, and particularly the high manganese iron ratio observed, be considered with the CCZ model. So it was two recommendations for the CCZ model. So another recommendations, general recommendations, was that there was a potential for the applicability of the CCZ model in the North Atlantic Ocean. And another was that contractor could test the model in the areas, and the ISA could test the model in the reserved areas. So it would be the specific test in the different contractors and the reserved areas. And last recommendation was that the geological model and prospectal guides have dealt extensively on the nodules morphology, nodule size and shapes, and also on the sediments. However, during the discussion following the presentation, it was observed that there is no uniformity in the classification scheme for all these parameters. All the contractors are using their own methods of classifications. This working group recommends a standard classification scheme for nodules morphology, sediment classification, etc. The authority should convene a workshop meeting of experts to resolve the standardization issue, and the standard scheme should be made applicable to all future applications and reports. That's it. Thank you very much.
Do we have any questions or comments for working group number one? Professor Halbach.
I'd like to comment the Atlantic Ocean. We have done some work in the North on tropical Atlantic Ocean and recovered nodules and crust, and both are of hydrogenetic origin. And my, well, it's just yesterday we didn't have a lot of data about the Atlantic Ocean, but there might be in the southern part of the South Atlantic Ocean a situation where the model could be used. But the thing is that the siliceous ooze sediments, which are surrounding the Antarctica, they have a different mineralogical composition or a biological composition, because in the CCZ, our model, it's related really to radiolaria, this kind of zooplankton. But in the South Atlantic, we have diatoms. And this has never been tested, whether nodules can grow on a siliceous ooze consistent of diatoms. So it is an interesting question. I think it has not checked. I can't remember if any kind of nodule was recovered from that area. So I think there we can get maybe
some new knowledge if this works or not. But diatom silicious ooze also has a completely different property. It's very sticky and so on. I have had samples like that, but the silicious ooze has a high porosity, but the diatom ooze does not have. So I don't know, but this is a very interesting question, also scientifically seen. Is it possible that the silicious ooze, if you take the SiO concentration, you find the same data as in our CCZ area, but it is a completely different kind of diatom particles, and they are very fine-grained, and the material is very sticky. So I think this is one very interesting point of view, which should be solved and should be investigated. The other point is coming back to the Atlantic Ocean. And some of you know I have presented a paper for hydrogenic crust probabilities in the Atlantic Ocean. And this is one point which I like to consider anyway for the marine minerals. That is, there might be a change in the future because we have a change in technology that some elements which are not have been considered in detail by us up to date may have in 5 or 10 years a very high importance also regarding the prices. In Germany, one institution has done a consideration about the development up to the year 2030. And we have also a kind of ranking list of trace metals. And I tell you, number one is gallium. They predicted that, for example, the gallium demand will increase 25-fold in the next 15 to 20 years. They also predict that's an increase for this trace metal of about 10 times. And the same is correct for neodymium, for indium, and germanium. So at present, they are not really considered. But in the future, I tell you, these elements may have an increased importance, and there will be an increase in demand. And what is the consequence? We have an increase in price. So maybe in 10 years, the sum of neodymium, lanthanum, yttrium, and cerium is more than nickel plus copper. And we have to consider this development, at least in our thinking for the future. That means we need more data about the concentration of these trace metals. And Vulcana, I like your molybdenum number, 0.056. These are 560 ppm. This is about half a kilogram of molybdenum per kilogram of our nodules. And molybdenum price has increased over the past 10 years about 10 times. It's unbelievable. This element molybdenum is a runner for the future. So maybe we can test if molybdenum can also be used for our model with the same interrelationships. In general, molybdenum goes with manganese, but I know with the nodules. This is also an open question. We should test further trace metals which have a high economic importance for the future, whether we can use our biogeochemical model regarding this in our CCZ nodule area. But in the Atlantic, my prediction is it's more a hydrogenetic world of precipitates of the ferromanganese material. And as I said, these elements considered or belong to the rare earth group, they go with the iron. And this is very interesting because nickel, cobalt, and so on, they go with the manganese. Molybdenum also goes with the manganese, but the rare earths do not. And you know that for the cobalt-rich crust, we have defined a water depth of 2,500 meters to have the optimum between 1,000 and 2,500. But we have a further increase for rare earth elements going in the deep water. So this may change our view, what is the optimum depth range. So really, I ask you and say, let's consider also in the future, I know there are not many data available, but we have to push it. We have to ask also the contractors, please analyze also molybdenum and the rare earth elements to get a review of that, because these elements are important for the future. Of course, nickel and cobalt too, but manganese, it's just the main element in the nodules, but it's not really a market element. So we have to consider all of these trace metals, and maybe the authority can ask the contractors, please, do you have a chemical analysis of these materials or these trace metals? Let us know, give us this, and we can input this or include this in our considerations.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments for working group number one? Professor Zhou? Oh, I'm sorry, Elva, excuse me.
Mine is a very small comment, and it adds actually to what Professor Hasberg just mentioned. And this is regarding to the Southern Atlantic. I think it is an excellent potential project, and it should just be improved. and move on into that. And the other is we were also analyzing the presence of a minimum oxygen zone.
Yeah.
That is not very well defined in that part of the ocean, but it is consistent, for instance, with India and the Eastern Pacific. So it will be interesting to find out what happens if there, if that is associated to it.
Yeah, yes, of
course. Dr. Zhou?
Yes, as I said yesterday afternoon, in my mind, the geological model of in CCZ is actually one part of the global model of the manganese nodules on the Earth, and so and I support the recommendation to step by step to do some the similar work for the other parts besides of the CCZ. And another aspect I also mentioned yesterday afternoon is I think for the work of seabed authority, maybe it is also at the stage to have some group to work on the establishment of the geological model of manganese crust and hydrothermal sulfide.
Thank you. Do we have any further comments or questions for this group? Okay, now let's move to working group number three. Dr. Elva Escobar Briones, who is also a member of the Legal and Technical Commission, will present the preliminary results from the environmental group. Elva?
I'm daring to present something that we have not reviewed in the full group. We had a very small session, almost for 45 minutes probably, and that was because we all split into the different groups one and two. So what I will be presenting is preliminary. It has not been reviewed by my colleagues, and I hope I can express exactly what we came up to, some of the few points that we reviewed yesterday. We expect to continue working on this today. I did make a prior PowerPoint presentation, so I will just read on that. Our group is environmental component, research plan, time series, site plan, and standardized data sets, many of which have been mentioned in the previous two groups. The participants of this group were Adam Cook, myself, Volcana, and Professor Zhu. The mission of our group was to recognize what from the accomplishments of the geological model we could deliver, evolve into seeing the role of environmental reports or provide as a guide to the environmental reports of the contractors, that we get better information from them, how we can help them to recognize zones of environmental interest that can provide us information as a feedback, and what the relevance of the geological model is in the environmental protection of the seabed. How can we recognize that? Another part of this mission or objective are the considerations for the future. What can we contribute to the seabed authority on identification and definition of habitats? What data are required to accomplish environmental assessments and recognize its impact in the CCZ? So, first of all, are the findings in benefit of the environmental issues that we were trying to understand. And this is that the geological model provides us a depth range trend, a topographic characterization with seamounts, hills, basins, and grabens, that allows us to recognize in some way potential habitat heterogeneity to the abyssal environment, which was initially considered as just one single environment, but we can see that there are sites that have changes in sediment, changes in the presence of seamounts, and nodal composition, and that we can see that this nodal composition varies locally at the size of patches and has a variability as well in scale of hundreds of meters. And this is defined by the type and the chemical characteristics of the nodules. The geological model provides as well a guide or a preliminary way of understanding future environmental studies. And it is, we consider it, it has established a baseline. So we also analyze what gaps and omissions were in the geological model. And from this we recognized that the resolution of the data is probably low at this point and it needs to be improved. We need a better understanding of the biological participation into the distribution and origin of the nodules. We need to understand better why the benthos changes, its abundance changes, and we need to have a better resolution of that information. We recognize that we need to encourage impact experiments at a habitat scale and encourage the contractors to collaborate with academic groups that are already working in that area or that have been supporting these studies. This should be by encouraging contractors to contact the appropriate scientific research institutes and promote interactions between the mining companies and the relevant international scientific programs that might exist. We started from the considerations that the formats that will define the resolution need to be discussed between scientists and contractors. We found that these formats and the strategies followed by each of these two different groups are very different in what the scope and what they analyze. And we can rescue common information that is useful and that can be compared, but there is information that will be left on the side because it cannot be compared because of the scales and of the levels in which it has been analyzed. The other is the key parameters that were identified by each of these two groups. Another consideration was that we need to ask very specific questions, and these need to be addressed to contractors or to scientists. In either one of these two formats that we started analyzing yesterday, which is impact analysis and the effect of exploration or the effect of extraction, and the other are the recolonization experiments that lead to the time series. We didn't make a profound analysis of these, so probably this is one of the themes that we will still need to discuss. We had a set of questions, and I will try to express to you what we discussed in those questions. For instance, one of the questions is, where should areas be looked at? Where should we try to find habitats? Or where should we try to encourage the contractors to look for? So first of all, we would like to encourage sampling in zones that were recognized by the geological model. And this would be, for instance, to standardize 6 zones or the 5 zones or the 3 zones, but it should be encouraged that these should be sampled or analyzed very systematically. The sampling initially should be limited to the ZZZ, but it should be eventually expanded to other areas as future models evolve, as factors are recognized for these new areas. For instance, maybe one factor was not recognized in one area, but a new area brings up this factor to be recognized. Factors that have been already recognized as common are primary productivity, seafloor conditions, topography, but others may appear and may be emergent. What priority features or factors need to be recognized in habitat types? We defined first that to recognize habitat types, we had already tools such as depth, slope, sediment types, geochemical gradients, and biological ecotones that have been recognized previously. At this point, we need to understand what will be the cutting points for defining these habitat types. For in an example, if we need to have a percentage of nodal coverage as a relevant factor, if we need to know a percentage or a value in composition for any chemical component in the nodules, for instance, nickel or molybdenum or cobalt. We need to follow standard strategies, for instance, for areas, for factors to evaluate, for contractors, and for the levels of resolution. And this would be, for example, if you would like that each contractor studies a different area recognized by the geological model, or if we would like contractors to all evaluate the same factors in each area that they study. If we need contractors to study commonly and simultaneously the same area so that we can understand that what they are providing us as data is the results of their analysis and that those analyses are standardized, or if those are local differences that they are finding. The other is the level of resolution that we would like to have the data coming to us. The number of types of potential habitats. We discussed that and we understand that we could see differences between substrates, hard substrate against soft substrate, with and without nodules, and within the abundance of nodules, the chemical composition of nodules, the patchy nature of the nodules and its in the area that covers, the patch and its effect to the benthos, or the benthos in regard to the patch, the scales of resolution for microbiota to megabiota, another evaluation should be the biological community between the types of nodules, and this is in regards to the previous point, and the methodologies that should be standardized to address all these different variabilities. Another question was, how can the geological model contribute to environmental studies in the future? We know that there are many data available from contractors: sediment, chemical components, nodules, environment, biota. We should try to make the best use of this resource available. At this point, we recognize that we need to improve the biological knowledge, and which is limited at this point for the model. And we need to improve the biological knowledge in relation to trace metals and major elements,